Hello everyone, I am Neeru and today we will be doing SSC CGL Tier 1 paper. The paper is according to the new pattern given by SSC and the paper code is 860. We will be doing paper code 860. I'll be doing the general awareness section with you. In the general awareness section, I'm going to be covering from question number 26 to question number 50. This is going to be covered in the general awareness section. I'll give you detailed explanations for each and every question. Let's begin. Question number 26. Who among the following founded the All India Muslim League? The All India Muslim League, it was founded at the time of partition of Bengal. And now let us take a look at who founded it. Who were the founders? Who among the following founded the All India Muslim League? This is my question. And my options are Sayyid Ahmad Khan, Muhammad Ali, Aga Khan and Hamid Ali Khan. These are my four options. Sayyid Ahmad Khan's name is associated to the Aligarh movement, under which he wanted to modernize the Muslims and he wanted the Muslims to adopt Western education. And this Aligarh movement, he started a school in Aligarh and then later this became the Aligarh Muslim University. He himself was a very, very educated person. He had retired as a judge and he wanted to modernize the Muslim population and he wanted education for them, modern education. But he himself wanted to stay away from politics and a lot of students feel that he is the founder of the All India Muslim League. He is not so. Muhammad Ali, Aga Khan and Hamid Ali Khan, these are our other options. Now, the founding meeting for the All India Muslim League was hosted by Nawab Sir Khwaja Salimullah. Nawab Sir Khwaja Salimullah of Dhaka. Dhaka, which is currently in Bangladesh, that time it was a part of India. And this meeting was attended by 3000 delegates. And there was Amir Ali, Sir Mia Muhammad Safi. These were the founding fathers who attended this meeting. And the name All India Muslim League, it was proposed by Sir Aga Khan III. You could be given a question as to who proposed this name. The name was proposed by Sir Aga Khan III, the third, and Nawab Sir Khwaja Salimullah of Dhaka, he is considered to be the founder of the All India Muslim League. But we do not have that name among our options. So we will go with the other founding fathers. And among the other founding fathers, we have Sir Aga Khan. So Aga Khan III, his name is important. He is considered to be the founder. And plus, he has also proposed the name for the All India Muslim League. Question number 26. Question number 27. The judges of the High Court can be removed from their office before the expiry of their term on grounds of proved misbehavior or incapacity by the. Who can remove them? The Chief Justice of India, the Chief Justice of the High Court, the President on the recommendation of the two Houses of Parliament or both Houses of Parliament with special majority. This is our question, question number 27. Our answer is going to be C, President on the recommendation of the two houses of the parliament. The procedure to remove the judges of the High Court and the Supreme Court, it's a very, very difficult procedure. And this was done so that the judiciary could work fearlessly and impartially. That is the reason, because we had to keep the three organs of the government, the executive, the judiciary and the legislature separate. Therefore, we wanted the judiciary to function in an independent way. And our constitution has laid down detailed guidelines to ensure the impartiality and independence of the judiciary. Article 124 subclause 4 talks about the removal of judges. And judges can be removed only on two grounds. One is your incapacity and misbehavior, and both of them have not been defined in the constitution. See, what does Article 124 subclause 4 says? It says a judge of the Supreme Court shall not be removed from his office except by an order of the president. The final order will bear the signatures of the president, and this order will be passed after an address by each House of Parliament, supported by majority of total members of the House and by majority of not less than 2/3 of the members of the house present and voting. So on the day of the voting, minimum 2/3 members of the house should be present and voting, and they should vote in favor of removing the judge, plus 2/3 of the supported by majority of the total membership of the house. After this has been done, it has to be presented to the president in the same session. Very, very important. There are 3 sessions of the parliament, and this bill has to be presented to the president on the same session. This removal on the ground of proved misbehavior and incapacity. Only when this procedure is followed can we remove the judge of a high court or the supreme court. A very, very difficult procedure has been laid down, and that is the reason that till date no judge has been removed by this procedure. So question number 27, the president is going to remove on the recommendation of the 2 houses of the parliament. But throughout this procedure, the judge will be given an opportunity to present his case before the House of Parliament. Question number 27, answer is C. Question number 28. The Khilafat movement was launched to protest against the humiliation of the Turkish Caliph, Aga Khan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah or Abul Kalam Azad. These are my options. Question number 28. These are my options. The Khilafat movement was launched to protest against what? The answer for question number 27 is A, the Turkish Caliph. This is the answer. Now, what is Khalifa? What is Caliph? Let's understand that. The Caliphate is an Islamic system of governance in which the state rules under Islamic law. You must have heard a lot in medieval history, when we were studying medieval history, that Iltutmish got recognition for his empire from the Khalifa. You must have heard of this. What does this mean? This means that he is getting a formal recognition from the head of the Muslim religious world. The Muslim religious world, the Caliphate is an Islamic system of governance in which the state rules under Islamic law. And Caliph literally means successor or representative and emphasizes religious authority for the state. Now, let's understand what was this Khilafat movement and why was it launched. We've understood what is Khalifa. Now, the World War I, it took place from 1914 to approximately 1919, we can say. In the World War I, Ottoman Empire, and Turkey was a part of this Ottoman Empire, was on the side of the Central Powers. And the result of this war was the defeat of the Central Powers. The Central Powers were defeated, and Turkey was among the Central Powers. After that, there was a treaty known as the Treaty of Versailles. In which Germany was very badly humiliated, and the territories of the Ottoman Empire were to be redesigned. They were to be redrawn. They were to be redrawn after the defeat in the First World War. Now, Ottoman Empire, Turkey was a part of the Ottoman Empire, and Turkey had a lot of religious places of the Muslims, plus the Khalifa also lived in Turkey, and the Khalifa was the head of the religious Muslim head. So now the boundaries of the Ottoman Empire were to be redrawn, and parts of it were to be shared among the by the opposite powers which had won. After the First World War, Caliph was deprived of his authority and territories. In 1920, leaders like Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, Hakim Azmal Khan, Ali Shaukat, all of them started a movement in support of Caliph. So, by this Treaty of Versailles, when the boundaries were to be redrawn and the Caliph was to be reduced of his powers and a lot of religious places of the Muslims were to be taken away, then all over the world, Muslims protested against this and they wanted the Khalifa to have a substantial power in his hand and the Muslim places in and around Turkey to be under the control of Muslims. Then, in support of this, even Indian Muslims rose and a movement called the Khalifa movement was launched in India. In India, Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar and his brother Maulana Shaukat Ali, both of them along with some other leaders, they formed an All India Khilafat Committee, and this committee was at Lucknow. And what were the two main demands of this committee? The two main demands were that the Caliph Sultan must retain sufficient territories so that he is able to defend the Islamic faith. And next was all the places which were the religious places of the Muslims in Arabia, Syria, Iraq, Palestine, etc., they must remain under Muslim control. So this was the background to the Khilafat movement. However, these two never happened. This was all about this question. Question number 29. Mumbai high oil fields are located on the, where are the Mumbai high oil fields located? They are located on the continental shelf of the Arabian Sea. Continental shelf of the Arabian Sea. This is the answer. Bombay High, also known as Mumbai High, this is an offshore oil field which is located in the Arabian Sea, 160 kilometers west of Mumbai. Discovered in 1974, the field has been operated by ONGC, that is Oil and Natural Gas Corporation of India. This is the answer for question number 29. Question number 30. Where is India's supercomputer Param located? Where is India's supercomputer Param located? Question number 30. Answer is B. Answer is B. It is located at Pune. What is Param? This is a series of supercomputers which are designed and assembled by Center for Development of Advanced Computing, CDAC, in Pune, India. And the latest machine in the series is the Param Kanchan Janga. Question number 30. Question number 31. Which river flows between the Satpura and the Vindhyas? Between the Satpura and the Vindhyas, where are the Satpura and the Vindhyas? I'll show you that also. My options are Godavari, Tapti, Gandak River and Narmada. Now, the Narmada is going to originate in eastern Madhya Pradesh and it will flow west across the state, a narrow valley between Vindhya Range and the spurs of Satpura Range. Let me show you in the map. Now, if you look on this side of the map, let me just circle this portion for you first. Here you can see the Narmada River. Here, see, this is the Narmada River. This is the Narmada River and here is the Vindhyan Range. I'll circle that for you. And here is the Satpura Range. And our question is, which river flows between both these? The river that flows between both these is the Narmada River. And just below Narmada, you will see Tapi River also flowing, which is known as the twin of Narmada or the handmaid of Narmada River. Very, very important rivers. And these two rivers are going to ultimately flow into the Bay of Bengal. Question number 32. Which one of the following organs converts glycogen into glucose and purifies the blood? A question related to biology. A question related to biology. Which one of the following organs converts glycogen into glucose and purifies the blood? These days you have a lot of questions on different enzymes, on different hormones in the bodies, different kinds of bones in the bodies, functions of various parts of the body. This is also one related to functions of various parts of the body. Question number 32. Which one of the following organs convert glycogen into glucose and purifies the blood? My options are liver, lungs, kidney and spleen. Question number 32. Answer is A, liver. And now I am going to tell you the functions of liver. The functions of liver, let's take a look. It performs these functions. Firstly, most important function of the liver is secretion of bile, and this bile consists of bile salts that break down fat globules. This helps the enzymes to convert them into fatty acid and glycerol. So first function is secretion of bile. Next, the liver secretes enzymes and juices that help in the process of digestion. Next is enzymes being secreted by it. Then we have the liver cells regulate the nutrients received by the body cells. They remove the excess glucose in the blood and store it in the form of glycogen. The liver stores nutrients like vitamins, iron and other minerals. The question that was asked, what purifies the blood? The liver purifies the blood of harmful substances such as drugs and chemicals and filters the bacteria, viruses and other microorganisms from the blood, and it is also responsible for producing cholesterol and certain amino acids. So in detail, all these are the functions of the liver. L-I-V-E-R. Question number 32. Question number 33. the capital of Kenya is? What is the capital of Kenya? Sometimes very simple questions are asked. Capital of a particular country, currency of a particular country, what is the parliament of a particular country called? Like I remember there was a question recently that was asked was that what is the parliament of Japan called? Question number 33, let's come back to that. The capital of Kenya is, the capital of Kenya, question number 33, answer is D, Nairobi. The capital, it is also the capital and the largest city in Kenya. Question number 34. Question number 34 is Sahyog Kaijin 2016 has begun off the coast of Chennai, Tamil Nadu in the Bay of Bengal, the 15th edition of bilateral exercise between. What is this Sahyog Kaijin? First, let's see that. Sahyog Kaijin, this was the 15th edition of, it's a bilateral exercise. Bilateral means two countries are going to be involved in this, and those two countries that are involved are India and Japan. India and Japan, it's the 15th edition of bilateral exercise by the Indian Coast Guard and its Japanese counterpart. And it is known as Sahyog Kaijin 2016. It had begun off the coast of Chennai, Tamil Nadu in the Bay of Bengal. Question number 35, you get questions on books and authors. This is one of them. Who is the author of the famous book, A Better India, A Better World? This is my question. This book has been written by N.R. Narayanan Murthy. N.R. Narayanan Murthy, and I needn't tell you who is N.R. Narayanan Murthy. You must be already aware about him. N.R. Narayanan Murthy, option C. N.R. Narayan Murthy is the founder of Infosys, and he has authored the book A Better India, A Better World. And what has he written in this book? And this book brings about the differences in India between the upper class and the lower class. Where the lower class is struggling, there are some people who are multi-billionaires and how they spend their money. It's about that. This book is a collection of 38 of his speeches made across the world. Murthy shows how values and good leadership can effectively bridge this demographic gap. The only solution to the problem of poverty is to create jobs with good disposable incomes. This is the answer for question number 35, N.R. Narayana Murthy. Question number 36. In silvery paints, what is the main constituent? Question number 36. Answer is A, aluminium powder. Aluminium powder is the main constituent present in silver paints. Question number 37. Question number 37. Which of the following is used by the higher concentration, which of the following is caused by higher concentration of nitrogen and phosphorus? High concentration of nitrogen and phosphorus causes what? Eutrophication, alkalinity, hardness, or acidity. These are my four options. Answer is going to be eutrophication. Eutrophication is related to water pollution. It is related to water pollution, and excess of nitrogen and phosphorus, if it is present in water, it's going to cause eutrophication. And now, what is exactly eutrophication? Let's understand that. Eutrophication, it's a kind of water pollution, and how is it going to happen? It's going to happen when excess nitrogen and phosphorus is present in the water. It is the ecosystem's response to addition of artificial or natural nutrients, mainly phosphate through detergents, fertilizers, sewage to an aquatic system. Now, what is going to happen? Enhanced growth of aquatic vegetation and phytoplankton and algal bloom disrupts the normal functioning of the ecosystem. The ecosystem, lake is suppose an ecosystem, and if too much of suppose phosphate and nitrogen is introduced in the lake, what is going to happen? Too much of phosphate, fertilizers are introduced, then what is going to happen? There is going to be excessive growth of plants. Okay, there's going to be excessive growth of aquatic vegetation in the water. Then what is going to happen? These plants which are there in the water, they will need oxygen to breathe. They will need oxygen to breathe. Excessive plants will take in excessive oxygen. So the level of oxygen in the plant is going to get reduced. When the level of oxygen in the water is going to get reduced, in the lake is going to get reduced, then the aquatic animals that are there, like fishes, crabs, etc., which need oxygen to breathe, they are going to start dying. and when they start dying, even to decompose these animals, you need oxygen. So shortage of oxygen will be there in the lake. This is known as eutrophication. Enhanced growth of aquatic vegetation or phytoplankton and algal bloom disrupts normal functioning of the ecosystem, causing a variety of problems such as lack of oxygen, which is needed for fish and shellfish to survive. Eutrophication decreases the value of rivers, lakes, and aesthetic enjoyment. Health problems can occur when eutrophic conditions interfere with drinking water treatment. When algae die, they decompose and nutrients contained in that organic matter are converted into inorganic form by microorganisms. This decomposition process consumes oxygen, which reduces the concentration of dissolved oxygen. The depleted oxygen level in turn leads to killing of fish and a range of other effects, reducing biodiversity. This is known as eutrophication. Often you get a question as to eutrophication is what kind of pollution: air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution. So firstly, the answer, it's related to water pollution. And why does it take place? When nitrogen and phosphorus are present in abundance in a water body, then it's going to take place. Question number 38 is, where is the doldrums located, or what are doldrums? First, we need to understand that it is located near the equator, near the polar sea, on the Tropic of Cancer, or on the Tropic of Capricorn. Doldrums are also known as the intertropical convergence zone. And see, this is the intertropical convergence zone, this thin white line which you see in between 0 degrees the equator, 5 degree north of the equator, and 5 degrees south of this equator. This area in between, this is known as the doldrums. Doldrums or intertropical convergence zone, this is a low pressure area around the equator where the prevailing winds are calm. Doldrums are located a little north of the equator, but the effect can be felt from 5 degrees north of the equator to 5 degrees south of it. The term appears to have arisen in the 18th century when cross-equator sailing became more common. This zone is the meeting place of two trade winds and it is called intertropical convergence zone, because here we have the winds coming from the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere meeting here. That's why it's called the intertropical convergence zone. Question number 39, important question. Which British Governor General introduced postage stamp in India? Question related to modern India. A question related to modern India. Now we are going to do this. Options are Lord Dalhousie, Lord Auckland, Lord Canning, or Lord William Bentinck. The answer is question number 39 A. The answer is A, Lord Dalhousie. Lord Dalhousie is going to be the answer. Lord Dalhousie, he is said to be the maker of modern India because he introduced trains, he introduced post and telegraph, he made Shimla the summer capital, and he is also known for a few other negative things also, like the doctrine of lapse was given by him. Lord Dalhousie, let's read about him. The accession of Lord Dalhousie started a new chapter in the history of British rule, and this is the time period from 1848 to 1856 while he was in India. Okay, and a lot of students are mistaken and they think that the revolt of 1857 took place in his time. It is not so. Revolt of 1857 took place in the time of Lord Canning. He introduced a number of reforms, and due to these reforms, he got the title Maker of Modern India, and modernization of India started. Now, what are those reforms? I have covered all of them here, and one of them is about the postage stamp. Dalhousie introduced a new form of internal communication in India. He is called the father of Indian railways because it was in his time that the first train ran between Bombay and Thane. In 1852, Dalhousie introduced the electric telegraph system in India. The first telegraph line was from Calcutta to Agra. It was opened in the year 1854. He started the postal department here. In 1854, a new post office act was passed and a uniform rate of half anna per letter was introduced for the first time. Prior to this, what used to happen, as far as the letter went, the charges were accordingly. But now a uniform rate of half anna per letter was introduced no matter how far the letter went, and for the first time postage stamp was issued, and thus the government also started a new source of income was generated for the government. A postal department was established for the whole country. The first stamps valid for postage throughout India were placed on sale in October in 1854, and the values were half anna, 1 anna, 2 anna and 4 annas. Then besides, Lord Dalhousie also started a public works department. He started a public works department, and chief works of this department was to construct roads, bridges, government buildings, etc. And Lord Dalhousie's special contribution was construction of the engineering college at Roorkee, which is known as IIT Roorkee these days. This was the first engineering college in India. It was started by Lord Dalhousie. So for all these things, Lord Dalhousie is well known. Question number 39, answer is Lord Dalhousie. Question number 40. The main factor for the accelerated growth of population in India is... What is the main factor for accelerated growth of population in India? We have a low birth rate and a low death rate. If we will have a low birth rate and a low death rate, then we will not have accelerated growth of population. A high birth rate and a falling death rate, a rising birth rate and a rising death rate. Then we have a rising birth rate and a high death rate. What do we mean by a rising birth rate and a rising death rate? That means the number of births are also increasing, and even the deaths are increasing. If so, a lot of people are born and a lot of people are dying, that means it will not have an accelerated growth of population. The answer for question 40 is B. A high birth rate and a falling death rate. If a lot of people are born, a lot of children are born and very few die, falling death rate means reducing death rate. That means it's going to cause a major jump in the population. So for question number 40, answer is B. And what is the reason for this accelerated growth of population? Obviously, now there is improvement in healthcare and there is a lot of advancement of technology, due to which fewer people are dying. Earlier there were epidemics, earlier there was plague, earlier there was smallpox, there were so many diseases which could wipe out a lot of people at the same time from the face of this earth. But now it is not so. There are vaccinations, there are immunization programs. So question number 40, answer is B. Question number 41, protection of interests of minorities is laid down under which article? This is a question of polity. So it simply asks us that the protection of interest of minorities is under which article? Question number 41, answer is C, 29, precisely 29, part 1. Article 29, subclause 1 of the Constitution of India allows all minorities in India to preserve and promote their language, script and culture. But I will even briefly tell you what is Article 19 and 32. Article 19 is very, very important among the fundamental rights. Article 19 is the most important article among fundamental rights guaranteed by the Indian Constitution. And Article 19 offers us 6 kinds of freedom. And originally there were 7, but now one has been deleted. First is the freedom of speech and expression, then the right to assemble peacefully without arms, right to form associations and unions, to move freely throughout the territory of India, to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India, then right to acquire, hold and dispose of property. This is no more a fundamental right. To practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or India. This is also a fundamental right. But however, these fundamental rights are not absolute and there are certain restrictions on them as well. And what is Article 32? Article 32 is called the soul of the Constitution and very heart of it. You are given a question as to which article is called the soul of the Constitution and the very heart of it. Answer is Article 32. Who called Article 32 the soul of the Constitution and heart of it? The answer is Dr. Ambedkar. Article 32. Supreme Court has included it in the basic structure doctrine. That means you can't change Article 32. It is in the basic structure of the Constitution. It is in the basic structure. Now, what is Article 32? Article 32 makes the Supreme Court the defender and guarantor of fundamental rights. That means if your fundamental rights have been encroached upon, infringed on, then in that situation you can approach the Supreme Court or even the High Court under Article 226. Further, power to issue writs comes under original jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. There are 5 writs of mandamus, habeas corpus, certiorari, quorumto and prohibition. The Supreme Court or the High Court will issue these writs and restore your fundamental rights. And what do we mean by original jurisdiction of the Supreme Court? This means that a person can approach the Supreme Court directly for remedy rather than by way of appeal. This is all about Article 32. Next question is, an element that does not occur in nature but can be produced artificially is, which is that element? That element is plutonium. Plutonium is it's highly toxic due to its radioactivity, and the greatest source of plutonium is irradiation of uranium in nuclear reactors, and plutonium is used to power some spacecraft. This is the use of plutonium. Question number 42. Question number 43 says, the locomotive organ of amoeba is, we have pseudopodia, we have parapodia, we have flagella and cilia. This is a question related to biology. So the locomotory organ of amoeba is pseudopodia. This is the answer. What is pseudopodia? These are temporary protrusions on the surface of the amoeba cell for movement and feeding. Suppose this is an amoeba, okay? What is it? Suppose it sees food here. What does it do? There are temporary extensions in its body. It's going to make these temporary extensions, engulf the food and digest it. These extensions, these are known as pseudopodia. What is parapodia? I'll explain the other options also to you. Parapodia, these are extensions of the foot, and these are found in aquatic animals which help them to swim. And flagella, these are thread-like structures, and they enable protozoa, bacteria, etc. to swim. Question number 44. A global conglomerate company acquired the Heritage Old War Office in London that was once inhabited by Winston Churchill. Name the organization or a name of the conglomerate who has acquired. The answer is Hinduja Group. The Hinduja Group, I would like to deduct this because I have taken this from a newspaper. The Hinduja Group said that it had acquired the Heritage Old War Office in London, and at one time this was inhabited by Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill used to live here, and the group said in a statement that it planned to restore and convert the 1100 rooms there into a 5-star hotel. So this old war office in London, it's going to be converted into a 5-star hotel by the Hinduja Group. Question number 44. Question number 45. Nutrients are recycled in the atmosphere with the help of certain microorganisms. What are those microorganisms? They are decomposers. Decomposers are those which work on the dead remains of flora, fauna, animals, etc. Decomposers, and what will they do? They are going to recycle the nutrients. Producers are those who produce their own food. Consumers are those who do not, like for example, plants are producers. They'll do photosynthesis and produce their own food. Consumers, a deer is a consumer. It will not produce its own food. It will feed on the plant. Decomposers are some bacteria, etc. Decomposers are organisms that break down dead or decaying organisms, and in doing so, they carry out the natural process of decomposition. So, question number 45, answer is C. Question number 46. Chloroform can be used as, what can chloroform be used as? Analgesia, anesthetic, anti-malarial, antibiotic. These are my options. And now let us see. Question number 46, answer is B. It can be used as an anesthetic. And now I will explain what is analgesia, what is anesthetic, anti-malarial and antibiotic. Analgesia is medicine that acts to relieve pain. It will get you rid of your pain. Anesthesia is a medicine that will make you unconscious for some time, and then after some time you will come back to your senses. Anesthesia, if you ever go to a doctor, etc., or you go to a big hospital, you will see one room and there'll be a doctor who's going to have anesthesia written there. That means his job is to give anesthesia. It's a drug which has the ability to bring about a reversible loss of consciousness, and chloroform is capable of doing this. Antibiotics, these are a group of medicines that are used to treat infections caused by germs, bacteria and certain parasites. They do not work against infections that are caused by, viruses. And finally, we have antimalarial, that is something which will work against malaria. And finally, antibiotic is explained here. Question number 46, answer is going to be B. 47. The real executive power of the state is exercised by who exercises the real executive power of the state? It is going to be exercised by question number 47A, the chief minister. The administration of the state is run by the Council of Ministers, headed by the chief minister. Question number 48. The policy which relates to government spending, taxing, borrowing, etc. is called, question number 48, it's known as the fiscal policy. Fiscal policy. Announcement of major fiscal changes are made in the annual budget, and fiscal policy is used primarily to influence the level of aggregate demand, distribution of income, distribution of expenditure, etc. Question number 48, answer is A. Question number 49. The book Audacity of Hope has been written by, it has been written by Barack Obama. The US President Barack Obama. Question number 49, answer is D. The last question to be done, question number 50. Bharat Ratna is designed like a leaf of, what is Bharat Ratna designed as? It's designed as a leaf of banyan tree, peepal tree, coconut tree, sandalwood tree. Bharat Ratna. Now see, I have put here the picture of Bharat Ratna for you on both sides. Now, the actual award is designed in the shape of a peepal leaf. Can you see this? We have done this in school when we were in school. We used to take a peepal leaf and keep it in one of our fat books, probably a dictionary or something like that. And then we could see the veins and everything. Yes, this is that same leaf, the peepal leaf. The actual award is designed in the shape of peepal leaf, and it has the word Bharat Ratna here written here, as you can see in Devanagari script in Hindi. And on the reverse side, you will see this. You will see this emblem from the Ashokan pillar. The reverse side of the medal carries the state emblem and motto. Our motto Satyamev Jayate is written right underneath this. So this is the design of the Bharat Ratna. I wish you all the very, very best. Thank you for watching my presentation. Bye-bye.